Welcome, everyone, to the Wilmot Institute's regular webinar series, which has as its purpose to highlight the immense diversity of the Baha'i teachings and the ways they contribute to the contemporary world, particularly to the prevailing discourses of society. Today, we're very pleased to welcome Nadema Agard, who will be presenting on the sacred feminine at the heart of the Baha'i Faith, Part 2. Part 1 was given in the spring of 2022, and we are looking forward to hearing the rest of it today. Now to introduce Nadema to you. Nadema Agard Winyan Luta is Cherokee, Lakota, and Powhatan. She's an artist, illustrator, curator, educator, lecturer, storyteller, writer, poet, published author, museum professional, and consultant in multicultural Native American arts and cultures. This is really quite an impressive list, Nadema. We're very happy.
Repatriation.
Thanks for fixing that. She has a Bachelor of Sciences degree from New York University and an MA in Art and Education from Teachers College.
Columbia University.
Columbia, thank you. Her work spans more than four decades and includes multiple solo exhibitions, group exhibitions, and guest curatorships, nationally and internationally. So with that introduction, I would like to turn the floor over to Nadema. Thank you so much for joining us, Nadema. We are really grateful that you've been able to participate in this webinar today. And I will.
Thank you, Robert. Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about the sacred feminine at the heart of the Baha'i Faith, part two, a world embracing vision. My previous talk was about the sacred feminine of indigenous peoples. And today I'm going to talk about the sacred feminine of other world peoples. So symbols are a united fabric of humanity, and art is the language of the spirit. So my presentation is a marriage between coded language and images. In traditional cultures around the world, the oceans, pearls, shells, fish, rivers, springs, grottos, vessels, including boats, canoes, and ships, earth, moon, Venus, morning star, trees, leaves, flowers, roses in particular, and gardens are all symbolically associated with the feminine divine. Of great importance is the heart. Also symbolic are the breast and the chalices formed from the breast of the divine feminine, whose number is 9, 13, and 28 are also associated with the feminine aspect. There are also the temples and cathedrals with rose windows as the sacred doors to receive the shaft of God's light in a cosmic union. Metals like copper and silver associated with the feminine aspect as well. There are also feminine colors, red and blue, blue and white, and the qualities of justice, mercy, wisdom, compassion, and healing, faith, hope, charity, mercy, forgiveness, grace, generosity, bounty, providence, and even glory are all feminine names. The Baha'i Faith and the glory of God have feminine words in their titles. And even Allah has a feminine ending. My Lakota name, Winyan Luta, means woman holy red, because there are two types of red. And Luta, or scarlet, is a sacred red. Crimson is also a sacred color in the red family that is mentioned in the Baha'i writings. The crimson arc may well be a symbol of the womb, the door or gate, the birth opening with the umbilical cord as a connection to the divine mother. Feminine words and birth symbolism abound in the writings. So here's two pieces of my work. One is called Generosity. The other is Wisdom, translated into English from the Lakota language, and I quote the writings, "There is no one, oh my God, who can deal bountifully with me, to whom I can turn my face, and none who can have compassion on me, that I may crave his mercy. Cast me not out, I implore thee, of the presence of thy grace, neither do thou withhold from me the outpouring of generosity and bounty." Quote, "O son of man, my calamity is my providence." Bahá’u’lláh. So here you see the copper jingles and the copper copper shells. The shells are here, and you have the pearls. Okay, those are the pearls. And silver is the halo. So Bahá’u’lláh's symbolism of hand of divine grace reminds me of the Native American symbol that is of the left hand of the feminine divine. Left-handedness was most prevalent in Native America, and we are the heart people. So it is important to note that the heart is on the left side. This is from an ancient Hopewellian culture of woodlands America, Native America. So there are four elements. Two of them are feminine. One is earth and the other is water. While the indigenous Americans have guardianship over the element earth, the Africans have guardianship over the elements of water, and whose position on the medicine wheel is horizontal, representing the colors blue or black of the West. This is a beautiful painting by an Italian artist, which is real interesting because there's many parallels between West African divine feminine and Italy, Italian Madonna. Ocean Mother, Virgin Maria, Yemaya of the African diaspora. They are all the one, they are all one. Quote, "The love of God is like the ocean. You can see it beginning, but not its end. So are the Baha'i writings like the ocean, immense in scope and with depths of meaning and infinite interpretations. For the Yoruba people of Nigeria and West Africa and the African diaspora in the Americas, Ocean Mother Yemaya is venerated as the divine feminine of their ancestors in Brazil, Cuba, Haiti, Puerto Rico, and wherever traditional African religion is practiced. She also has a great redemptive, restorative, and healing power that embodies feminine qualities like compassion, mercy, tenderness. Her colors are blue and white, just like the colors of the Mediterranean goddess, and later the color of Virgin Maria or Mary. And I just want to qualify that it's not a dark blue, it's more like a light blue. Here's a soundtrack from Brazil, a song for Yemaya. I hate to cut it off, but we have to move on. I could listen to that all day, and it kind of puts you in a trance kind of mindset as well. So as I said, her colors are blue and white, just like the Mediterranean goddess known as Venus, who was born from the ocean and later the same color associated with the Virgin Mary. Here's a famous painting of the birth of Venus, or the Greeks call her Aphrodite, the goddess of love. And here we have the Virgin Mary surrounded by a star halo. So the Virgin Mary or Maria, whose name references mare or ocean, is depicted in a vesica piscis or mandorla or yoni. The mandorla created by two intersecting circles and which literally means almond in Italian represents union. It is perhaps the most ancient sacred symbol known to humankind, said to have been inscribed on the Ark of the Covenant, also known as the vesica piscis, which is literally translated as fish bladder. So there's an association again with the water. It symbolizes the sacred geometrical pattern of life on earth. The yoni is a metaphor for nature's gateway of all births. I call it the sacred door because you come from the spirit world to this earthly plane through that holy place. And so I see this place as a holy place. The title Virgin Maria refers to an archetype, not an actual person. Maria contains the Latin root for the word mare, that means ocean in Italy, where the Virgin is venerated as the patroness of fishermen. Her image is put to sea on boats, which are female symbols, as protective blessing gestures to assure a bountiful catch, as seen in the Italian movie Il Postino. Mare becomes Maria, and so to marinate is to make tender, a feminine quality of the sacred divine. She is also associated with the star of the ocean, or Stella de Mare in Italian, and Stella Maris in Latin, which refers to Polaris, the star Polaris. So it's interesting to note that there's this eight-pointed star at the Baha'i Shrine and Garden in Haifa, Shrine of the Bab. And in Haifa is also the Stella Maris Monastery. I thought that was very interesting information. But for the Lakota people, that's the eight-pointed star is the morning star, which is also the goddess Venus in other traditions. This is a piece of this is one of my artworks. It's called Great Lakes Yoni. I painted it when I lived in Minnesota and lived among the Ojibwe people, the indigenous people of the Great Lakes. The vessel of devotion as a traditional Ojibwe birch bark canoe is feminine while the oar is masculine. So we have the women's colors are red and green, and they're worn by the initiate during a coming of age ceremony in the Bedewewin tradition of the Ojibwe. I was really blessed to attend one of these ceremonies. So red and green isn't just colors for Christmas. It really is associated with the divine feminine. So in the writings of Bahá’u’lláh, there are many references to the ocean mother, shoreless ocean of my incorruptible wealth, ocean of knowledge, ocean of favors, ocean in whose depths are concealed innumerable pearls of great price of surpassing luster, whose depths lay hidden pearls of wisdom, ocean of heavenly wisdom, and of thy grace, ocean out of which all seas have proceeded and with which every one of them will ultimately be united. He also describes her accoutrements as, quote, the pearl of wisdom and utterances, the shell, the great sea of knowledge. And here you have an image of the ocean mother, Yemaya, Virgin Mary, and Venus on the shell. As mentioned earlier, shells are associated with the feminine. Great God, this sea had laid up lustrous pearls in store. The wind had raised a wave that casted them ashore. So put away thy robe and drown thyself thereon and cease to boast of skill. It serveth thee no more. Lord, pitiful are we. Grant us the favor, for bestow upon us a share from the ocean of thy wealth. Needy do thou satisfy us, abase, give us thy glory, Abdu'l-Bahá and Bahá'u'lláh. So here's my work, and this is the soundtrack that inspired this work. This work is dedicated to the Ocean Mother, Jemaya, and the Virgin Maria, and she's the daughter of the moon. Although we as Baha'is do not have actual baptism rites, Bahá'u'lláh's writings have numerous metaphors of spiritual baptism. He makes reference to aquatic immersion on many occasions regarding Ocean Mother, Jemaya, Virgin Maria. Quote, immerse themselves in the ocean of his utterance, immerse yourselves in the ocean of my words, that ye may unravel its secret and discover all the pearls of wisdom that lie hidden in the depths, or it probably is a typo, beneath the ocean of thy forgiveness, faced with the restlessness of the Leviathan of glory, immerse me for my sick sins have utterly doomed me. Consider the ocean, how serene it lie, how majestically it reposes within its bed. Yet the wind of the will of the eternal beloved caused countless ripples, innumerable swells to appear upon its surface, each wave distinct and divergent from the other. All the people of the world today are preoccupied with the ebb and flow of these waves and are oblivious of the stupendous might of the sea of seas, who every movement lay it bare, the signs of him who is unconstrained, Bahá'u'lláh. The River Mother Oshun and the Black Madonna. In the Yoruba tradition, there's another water mother besides Jemaya. She is Oshun. Oshun is the river mother venerated in West Africa and by those of the African diaspora. Although in the guise of La Virgen de la Caridad de Cobre, or the Virgin of the Charity of Copper, she is still venerated in Brazil, the Caribbean, and elsewhere in the Americas. In Haiti, she is known as Esli or Erzuli Freda. Also associated with Our Lady of Częstochowa, the Black Virgin of Poland. She is also associated with the Black Virgin Maria of Guadalupe in Spain, not to be confused with the Earth Mother Guadalupe in Mexico. She is described as both Oshun and the Christian Virgin in the film Rainbow and the Serpent. I usually don't watch Wes Craven movies, but this one was quite educational. This is the Virgin of La Virgen de la Caridad de Cobre is the patroness of Cuba. So I mentioned that she's the charity and copper, feminine words, feminine images. And here's an image of Santa Maria de Guadalupe from Spain, which is a very different divine feminine than the Virgin of Guadalupe from Mexico, who we talked about last time. And Our Lady of Częstochowa, the Black Virgin of Poland. When they found all these images, they thought they were dirty and they were trying to clean them. And then they realized that these faces were black. They weren't dirty faces. The River Mother, described by Bahá'u'lláh as the river that is life indeed and the river of divine utterance, is part of the same pantheon as Jemaya. In the writings, he shows their relationship. Say the rivers of divine wisdom and utterance which flow through the tablet of God are joined to this most great ocean. Could ye but perceive it? O divine providence, all existence is begotten by thy bounty. Deprive it not of the waters of thy generosity. Neither do thou withhold it from the ocean of thy mercy. Abdu'l-Bahá also makes the connection between the two sisters, with the great ocean tide is flooding every little stream. Like her sister ocean, the river mother is a healer. Like her sister ocean, river mother is a healer, according to Bahá'u'lláh's prayer. Deliver me from the ills that have encircled me and wash me thoroughly with the water of thy graciousness and mercy. And attire me with the raiment of wholesomeness through the forgiveness, thy forgiveness and bounty. This is a billboard that I did for Land Back, an Indigenous movement. And as you see in the blue band, it says, Earth is our mother, water is life. And that blue band represents the river mother. Oshun, Sister Yemaya, La Virgen de Caridad de Cobre, Erzuli Freira, and are referred to by Bahá’u’lláh as the river that is life indeed, and the river of divine utterance. So water is life is a really important slogan that became popular in 2016 with the pipeline protests. And here Bahá’u’lláh has said it, you know, 100 years before, that the river is water is life. And then I want to note that in the writings, there's a lot of coded language regarding the divine feminine and and her eternal presence. Like I interpret the miracle of the loaves and fishes as gifts from Earth Mother and Ocean Mother. And then Jesus was baptized in River Jordan, which is the River Mother, Oshun. And Jesus walked on water, who's his Ocean Mother, Jemaya, Virgin Maria. As an artist, the feminine divine is my muse. And I relate to the writings of Bahá’u’lláh that say, quote, river of arts is flowing out of the sea of this region. So you see this beautiful painting of a boat, which obviously is a mandorla in shape, and the beautiful rendition of the waves and the fish, which is his catch. And the fish is associated with the Virgin Mary. Now we're going to talk about Wyoming, Little Sister Spring, and the Grotto Mother of Lourdes. The spring, a feminine symbol of healing water that is connected to the rivers and oceans, are described in the writings of Bahá’u’lláh as fountains of soft flowing water of celestial power. Born in 1844, the same year His Holiness the Bab declared, Bernadette Subaru, later canonized as Saint Bernadette, received an apparition at a nearby grotto of the Virgin of Lourdes, dressed in white with a blue girdle, who revealed miraculous spring water. During her ninth apparition, the water began to flow. At the request of the Virgin, she drank the salty spring water on her fourth attempt. This number for the Lakota is a sacred representation of the feminine realm of space. The four directions represents that, and space and time. We are born of space and time is male. In the land of Spotted Eagle, the Lakota scholar Luther Standing Bear wrote, though the Lakota lived near the streams, they had a special sentiment for springs and the purity of spring water. Springs were brought up by a living force or spirit called Wyoming-lláh, where whenever one lays down to drink from a spring, they said to it, Wyoming-lláh, have pity on me as I drink. As boys, we lay and watched the water bubbling up from the earth, feeling that it could not come up without some force back of it. So in it, we see the great mystery. So it was with a feeling of submission and human limitation that we whispered, Wyoming-lláh, have pity on me as I drink. And this passage is a lesson of humility. Water is life, and we must approach life with great humility. Also, the word Wyoming-lláh has a feminine prefix, we, and the word mystery is a word often associated with the feminine divine. Abdu'l-Bahá wrote, from the springs of love and truth and unity will the true shepherd give his sheep to drink the water of knowledge from the heavenly cupbearers. And here's the soundtrack of our dear, beloved, esteemed brother who passed, our Baha'i brother who passed, called the Morning Star Song. I won't say his name because in Lakota tradition, we're not supposed to say his name, but I wrote his name for you to know who he is. Very sad losing our dear brother. He was a very close friend of myself and my family. So we're going to move on to our divine feminine of Asia. And we're going to talk about Geechee Jolten, Kuan Yin, and Tara. Now, Geechee Jolten, in this image, is a Japanese Buddhist goddess. She represents fertility, prosperity, beauty, and good fortune in Japanese Buddhism, similar to Venus or Aphrodite, and Lakshmi in Hinduism of India. And then we have Kuan Yin, who is the goddess of compassion, very important primal figure in Buddhism of China. And I was told that she was once a man and then she became a woman. And then there's Tara. And Tara is from the Tibetan tradition. There's a white and green aspect. She's the goddess of compassion from Tibetan Buddhism and Hinduism, whose name means star, resembling the, she resembles the Virgin Mary or Stella Maris in that Polaris is also the star associated with her as the protectivist of travelers and savior from suffering. Like Venus, she is born from water. And I kind of see this water lotus image with Tara. And then we have our water lily image in Native American tradition. So there's this water lotus and water lily. It's kind of interesting, the parallels. And then we have this beautiful Lakshmi, a Hindu goddess of prosperity and beauty and fertility. She's associated with the lotus that symbolizes rising above the material world through divinity. So we have on her, on the left, her image. And then this is an actual altar that I set up with my Indian neighbor to celebrate Diwali. And then on the bottom left, you have the house of worship in India called the Lotus Temple, because it was built to represent the lotus. And then my work called Buffalo Skull Lotus, which is part of a series. And then I'm going to play the soundtrack. Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry to be so abrupt, but we need to move on again. And that music is also very enticing and relaxing and makes you kind of just want to relax, you know? Beautiful. And now we're talking about the breasts of the breasts as emblem of nurturing and education and revelation. Bahá’u’lláh refers to the breasts to two founts of gleaming milk out of the pure milk drawn from the breasts of thy loving kindness. Give me to drink, for my thirst had utterly consumed me. O breasts of this temple, we verily have caused all things to mirror forth thy reality and made thee as a mirror of our own self. Shed them upon the breasts of thy all created things, the splendors of the light of thy Lord, that they may be freed from all illusions and limitations. Now, this is a detail of a work that I did called Moon Breast Mothers, and it was dedicated to the moon goddesses of three different community cultural groups, people from around the world. Koyoshauki of the Mexica people, known commonly as the Aztec. And then Diana of Ephesus from ancient Greek and Roman culture. And Hina of Polynesia, who is the goddess of many Polynesian people. They call her Hida, Hina, the Maoris, the Samoans, Tahitians, Hawaiians. And so this piece is also for me represents at the time that I constructed this piece in 2003, it represented the nine houses of worship and the nine major religions, number of the goddess. And then here we have a quote from Abdu'l-Bahá, what a love he had cast the breast of humankind. Oh God, rear this little babe in the bosom of thy love and give it milk from the breast of thy providence. Oh my Lord, I am a child of tender years. Nourish me from the breast of thy mercy. Train me in the bosom of thy love. Educate me in the school of thy guidance and develop me under the shadow of thy bounty. Dilate the breast to the signs of thy oneness. Thus the lights of mercy and beneficence may shine upon you. The heavenly table descend for you. Your Lord may bestow upon you the greatest gifts and favors, whereby your breasts may become dilated, your hearts gladdened, your souls purified, and your eyes enlightened. And now I'm going to play a soundtrack from the inauguration of the Samoan House of Worship in the 1980s. There was a friend of mine who, one of the Baha'is who lived in, was part of my Baha'i community here in New York City. And he was from Algeria. And he was just a wonderful Baha'i. And he went to Samoa. He visited Samoa for the inauguration, and it was just so beautiful to get this this soundtrack from the inauguration. And I surprised many of Samoans that came to visit me who were living in New York at the time, or a lot of young Samoans were here that were going to school in I'm not sure what's going on with this soundtrack. Let me try. Okay. Here it's, I sorry, I didn't have it on. I think we're having a little technical difficulty. Okay. Okay, here we go. Wow, that was very joyous. And I would love to have listened to the whole thing, but again, we have to move on to the next subject. And the next subject is the chalice, the Holy Grail, the image of the heavenly cupbearer with the quote, wine cup of heaven, described by Abdu'l-Bahá, is the feminine divine in her chalice, an archetypal symbol of Christianity known as the Holy Grail. Bahá'u'lláh refers to this symbolic vessel of womanhood as the chalice of eternal life, of immortality, of imperishable glory, of my loving kindness, and the chalice of constancy. Abdu'l-Bahá also refers to this accoutrement formed from the breast of the divine feminine as the chalice of loyalty. And while I was doing this, organizing this PowerPoint, and I realized that that our measurements are measured in as cups in modern day. So maybe it had something to do with the chalice, actually. And now we're moving on to the womb of the sacred feminine, the crimson arc of the faith. Ramat, the name for the Baha'i month of mercy, resembles the Hebrew word rahamim, that means both compassion and womb. A metaphor for the womb of the divine feminine in the writings is for me the crimson arc, a vessel filled with the lifeblood like the symbol of the wine cup in the Catholic Mass. It is also important to note that sea vessels have been considered female, and with a few exceptions, given names of women and of feminine qualities, for example, the bounty. For me, my work, Buffalo Skull Lily, is a metaphor for the womb. The buffalo skull is a metaphor for the womb. And then Bahá'u'lláh says, blessed is he who preferred his brother before himself. Verily, such a man is reckoned by virtue of the will of God, the all-knowing, the all-wise, with the people of Baha who dwell in the crimson arc. Bahá'u'lláh once says, once again, we exhort all believers to observe justice and fairness and to show forth love and contentment. They are indeed the people of Baha, the companions of the crimson arc. And in the hidden words, Bahá'u'lláh makes mention of thy mother's womb. So this is a cover from the Tablet of the Holy Mariner, which we will discuss further. In the Tablet of the Holy Mariner, an illustrated guide to Bahá'u'lláh's mystical writings in the Sufi tradition by Michael Source, there's a reference to this sacred red. In the Bab's first book, an unconventional commentary on the Quran Surah of Joseph, he referred to crimson colored arc of ruby whereon none shall sail but the people of Baha, people of glory. Michael Source describes the important symbols with their correlations in biblical and Islamic scripture. For example, the Ark of Eternity references Noah's Ark and the Ark of the Covenant in the Old Testament. Eternity for the indigenous people is the realm of the feminine divine. Eternal time is documented in the sacred art of Lakota women. To make this a presentation in 2007, I returned to the eternal city of Rome, Italy, after more than 30 years. Eternal time, the realm of the sacred feminine. I have interpreted a cosmic codex of the Lakota people called a kapemni. It is a design painted on rawhide containers by the Lakota and other indigenous women of the Northern Plains. They were the first abstract artists who did earth paintings on rawhide. Their work is a documentation of eternal time. My modern flat interpretation is also a documentation of eternal time, but in reality, It is three-dimensional. The cosmic symbolism of the X shape called the Kapemni in the Lakota language is really the touching of two cones. The lower one, the feminine terrestrial, is like a teepee. The upper on the male celestial is like an ice cream cone. Where they meet is the four directions as space and where the stars are born. It represents mutual reciprocity and respect, heaven and earth, male and female, day and night, yin and yang, and therefore the equality of men and women. It is interesting that the Virgin Maria of Guadalupe has a similar TP shape. So this particular image is called Parflesh Vision of Heaven and Earth Giving Birth to the Stars. And now we talk about the umbilical cord as the cord of healing. I have interpreted the many references to cords in the writings as umbilical cords that are connected to the feminine aspect of the divine. I am but a poor creature, O my Lord. I have clung to the hem of thy riches. I am sore sick. I have held fast to the cord of thy healing. Lay hold on thy cord, holding fast to the cord of thy love, clinging to the cord of thy generosity, the cord of constancy. And my work is called Earth Mother and Children of the Four Sacred Colors. And for me, as a Baha'i, it represents race unity, that we all come from one mother, the earth. We're representing the four sacred colors of humanity, not races, because we're only one human race and we're all different colors. And then the flowers and gardens are important in symbolism and in the Baha'i writings. Bahá’u’lláh writes, "Hear me, ye mortal birds, in the rose garden of changeless splendor, a flower hath begun to bloom, compared to which every other flower is but a thorn. In the garden of thy heart, plant naught but the rose of love, Bahá’u’lláh." Again, this is an example of my work from the series called Buffalo Skull Series, and this one is for the rose, and that represents the indigenous people. And here we have all four of them representing all the four colors of humanity, the Caucasian, the indigenous, the African, and the Asian. Bahá’u’lláh describes flowers and gardens as feminine symbols of the Earth Mother. For example, rose garden of unfading splendor of knowledge, roses of wisdom and tulips of understanding, hyacinths of divine wisdom, the lilies of ancient wisdom, blossoms of knowledge and certitude, and the myrtles of wisdom and utterances. Abdul Baha refers to the 100-petal flower as a metaphor for cultivation. He wrote, "Consider the flower of a garden, though different in kind, color, and form and shape, as a metaphor of humanity in all its diversity." He also states, "Deliver me from darkness, make me a brilliant light, free me from unhappiness, make me a flower of the rose garden, and cultivate this fresh plant in the rose garden of thy love, aid it to grow through the shower of thy bounty." And then we have the mother book, the crimson book. "Say, O people, be obedient to the ordinance of God, which have been enjoined in the Bayan by the glorious, the wise one. Verily, he is the king of the messengers, and his book is the mother book, did you not know? Ordain for me, O my Lord, and for those who believe in thee, that which is deemed best for us in thine estimation, as set forth in the mother book." And here we have mothers of the four sacred colors, indigenous, Asian, Caucasian, and African. And then there are trees, leaves, and fruit that also has feminine symbolism. The tree, for example, in the writings, Bahá’u’lláh refers to the tree of divine unity, the fruit fruits of his oneness, the leaves of detachment, fruit of the blessed tree, the fruits of the human tree. Regard thou faith as a tree, and fruit, leaves, boughs, and branches are and have ever been trustworthy, truthfulness, uprightness, and forbearance. And that reminds me of the four, there are four virtues right there, and four being a really important number that's represents the four directions and the space and the feminine. Oh, a children of the dust, tell the rich of midnight sun of the poor, least heedless, lead them into the path of destruction and deprive them of the tree of wealth. And of course, the tree of wealth is the tree of life, and this beautiful work of art is by Bernard Meninsky. And now we have the tree, leaves, and fruit, focus on the leaf. According to Native tradition, the most tenacious yet gentle leaf can be remain on the tree through the worst storms. They represent the spirit of the woman who, according to a Cheyenne proverb, are the backbone of the nation, a nation that cannot be conquered until the hearts of these women are crushed to the ground. Luther Standing Bear, the Lakota writer and scholar, wrote in Land of Spotted Eagle, a dedication to his mother that states, "For it is the mothers, not the warriors, who create a people and guide their destiny." Likewise, the most great holy leaf, the sister of Bahá’u’lláh, demonstrated a tremendous dedication, steadfastness, tenacity, strength, and courage, and influenced the destiny of the faith. And she was that gentle leaf that remained on the tree through the worst of storms. This beautiful artwork is done by American artist Georgia O'Keeffe, red and brown leaves. Very beautiful rendering of leaves. And then we have the fruit. Beneath the shadow of the wings of thy mercy, shelter me with the fruits of thy tree, of thine eternity, nourish me. Oh, of divine bestowal, Abdul Baha said, it can make a tiny seed a lofty tree. And of the Christ, he wrote, consider the days of Christ when none but a small band followed him. Then observe what a mighty tree that seed became. Behold ye its fruitage. Because the fruit contains the seed. It is a beautiful painting by a French artist. I love his work, Pierre Bonnard. Okay, so this is a piece that I did called Healing of the Mother. It's made, it's mixed media with tobacco, sweetgrass, and sage, which is our sacred plants that we use when we pray and for ceremonial. Was very interesting when I was doing this piece is that I was working on it and I was thinking, I'd like to put sweetgrass on this piece, but I'm not sure. I would have to have the blessings of the community. I was living in Minnesota at the time. And then this one woman knocked on my door and she says, I have a gift for you. And it was a sweetgrass. And then I knew I had their blessing to make this piece. 9, the number of the feminine divine. I believe Bahá’u’lláh is describing the 9 major religions in the following. Say, we are revealed our verses in 9 different modes. We have revealed our verses in 9 different modes. Each one of them bespeaketh the sovereignty of God, the help in peril, the self-assisting. Nueva hierba, or 9 grass, is a feminine divine of Mesoamerica. In the Caribbean, there is the belief in las nueves potencias, or the 9 powers. The Virgin of Lourdes' miracle occurred on her 9th apparition, and novenas are 9 days of solemn prayer for the sacred feminine. Feminine ending in 9. referring to the personification called Sophia, Bahá’u’lláh wrote, "Wisdom is God's emissary. In the city of justice, it is unrivaled speaker who in the year 9 illumined the world with the joyful tidings of this revelation." I'm sorry, I'm going to start all over again. Okay, so okay, spirits want to play with me. This is the conclusion of my talk, the sacred door of life and death, the sacred threshold. In Native traditions, women are sacred because we give birth. For us, giving birth is a sacred act. And the place where we give birth is a sacred threshold. It is sacred because we come from the spirit world to this material world through that door. The place that we are born from is often referred to as a sacred door of life, the place where material life begins. In the Baha'i writings, this door is on a spiritual plane. And the birth is still another sacred birth from the material plane into the heavenly realm of the concourse on high. It is the eternal cycle. Death is birth, and birth is life, and life is death, and death is birth. This idea is exemplified in lyrics of a song by El Gran Combo de Puerto Rico that goes, "Yo soy la muerte. Yo soy la muerte soy, yo soy la muerte," or death, is a female with death as his sacred door to the eternal life. His Holiness the Bab wrote, "Open to my face the portals of thy grace and graciously confer upon me thy tender mercy and bestowals." His title, the Bab, meaning the gate, conjures a cosmic image of the greatest door of the birth of the faith and the gates to the heavenly realm guarded by Saint Peter, a metaphor for the sacred door that takes you to a spiritual birth. According to Abdul Baha, the gates of the kingdom are open wide and every favored soul is seated at the banquet table of the Lord, receiving his portion of the heavenly feast. He adds the portals of his blessings open wide and specifically mentions the sacred threshold. On the bottom right hand is a codex, Aztec codex of nueve hierba, nine grass, who is a Mixtec goddess of death. And basically she's the midwife to the spiritual realm. So with that, I'm going to put on this very happy song about death. And it's by El Gran Combo de Puerto Rico. It's a salsa song. It's meant to be danced to. So if you want to get up and stretch, this is the time.
La muerte soy,
yo soy la
oiga
muerte,
que soy la muerte.
La muerte soy.
jardín trae un cariño que yo quiera ciegamente. Puede vivir sin temor que vivirá eternamente.
Thank you. That's the conclusion of my presentation.